Recorded Books presents Hard Road to Vengeance by William W. Johnstone. Narrated by Jack Garrett. Chapter 1. 2 months ago. Denton I. Pullcross owned one square block of increasingly valuable real estate in the pulsing heart of downtown St. Paul, Minnesota. The proprietors of all manner of businesses paid sizable annual fees to Mr. Pullcross for the privilege of earning money in such a prime location and in proximity to such a civic leader as Denton I. Pullcross. Yes, indeed, it was a much-sought stretch of storefronts. But as popular as Millie's Millinery, Tumlin's Menswear, and the Circle Cafe were, none could ever hope to match the annual revenue generated by a business nested not along that lucrative face of the block, but behind a steel door on a side street, twice removed from the bustle of commerce. This unlikely location was the beating black heart of Denton I. Pullcross's business dealings. The establishment, the Dandy's Haven, Gentleman's Club and Reading Room, was not advertised, was not spoken of by the privileged men who were its members, nor was its presence known by the general public. Indeed, not even a sign nor number marked the entrance's location. The door itself was a batter-proof, plate-steel portal, two-thirds of the way down the alley. A small sliding panel at face height was manned from inside by a coarse brute in a tight necktie, whose knuckles topped hands larger than the faces of most of the clientele. But it wasn't their head sizes Mr. Pullcross was concerned with. It was the girth of their wallets. Once inside, members in good standing, powerful men all, with much money and a yearning to spend it on distractions unavailable to them elsewhere, entered a vast room with gaming tables, massage rooms, banquettes with curtains for intimate entertainments, and more. A vast assortment of the world's most sought-after libations were served by women, also from all over the world, a curated collection of beauties whose looks rated them among the most stunning specimens from their respective countries. Flanked by two burly gents in tuxedos, and far to the rear, stood a thick mahogany door with a brass knob that led to the outer office of Denton Pullcross, aforementioned owner and proprietor of the Dandy's Haven, Gentleman's Club and Reading Room. Then came his office, a sumptuous leather and wood-filled, high-ceilinged room, with bookshelves and plush seating, dominated by a massive desk. Denton often sat behind it, puffing cigars and counting cash, and bullying city officials and paying off policemen, and ordering supplies and bartering for the same. Through a door behind his desk was another room, with handsome wood panels and carpet. Unused much of the time, it was used for extra special events, and only his extra special clients were invited, only the wealthiest among the usual milling mass of Tony members. Tonight, one of those special events was taking place. "Now, gentlemen," said Denton I. Pullcross, striding to the middle of the room and thumbing his satin smoking jacket's black velvet lapels. "Who among you is interested in a taste of the exotic?" He gazed upward as if in deep thought and stroked a gray-flecked dagger beard that did less than he thought in concealing his double chin. A roomy, boozy smear of shouts of "Hear, hear!" rippled through the room, along with much boot stamping and cane tapping. He snapped his fingers, and a narrow wood panel at the rear of the room swung inward. A flash of red appeared, seemed to hesitate before moving through the doorway, then was shoved forward. The flash stumbled, righted itself, and became a woman with bare limbs and wearing a rather short vermilion dress. Behind her struggled a thin, not very tall, leering man in a black suit and hank of oily, too black hair that slipped down over his eyes above a long, bulbous, red-tipped nose. He struggled because she struggled, bound as she was behind her back at the wrist with wraps of a gold chain. This contrivance forced her chest forward, and the result caused gasps of glee among the assembled jowly white men. She was tall, slender, but not too slender, buxom, and her glowing skin was the color of powdered cocoa. Long, gleaming midnight black hair sat piled high atop her head. Her long neck, arms, shoulders, and legs were bare. Hands holding drinks trembled, cigars drooped, lips were licked, and sweaty brows were dabbed with pocket kerchiefs. Denton I. Pullcross smiled, at least until a scuffling sound and a low, throaty growl from behind him spun him around, eyes glaring. What he saw was what all the portly men in the room saw, and they all shared surprised looks that grew horrified. The stately, chain-bound woman had spun on the greasy man bedeviling her. She growled and lunged and jerked and spun around, and in doing so, pulled the man toward her so they were face to face. In eye-blink speed, she bent down from her superior height and bit the tip of his bulbous red nose, then jerked backward, tugging the screaming man with her. Blood sprayed, spritzing her face and running down her chin. She did not let go. She ground her teeth tight together and wiggled her head back and forth as if to sever the offending proboscis. The flailing, shrieking man soon righted himself and pried her jaw apart enough he could jerk his face away from the snarling woman, though two of his fingertips suffered a similar treatment as his nose. He shoved her away, and she stumbled once more, on shoes with heels that lent her already lofty height an impressive stature. She quickly righted herself and stood with her bloodied teeth gritted, her breath heaving and her flinty eyes glaring at the fleshy faces ringing her. Strands of her hair worked loose from the impressive pile atop her head, lending her face an even wilder look as she stared through narrowed eyes at the men. The man she'd attacked was doubled over and gripping his face. As blood leached between his fingers, his screeches were muffled by his hands, but the words were unmistakable, and they were nearly as shocking to the assemblage as the young woman's display. Nearly. For several long moments, Denton I. Pullcross was uncertain what to do first. He could pull a gun on the woman, which would necessitate him having to lift his trouser leg and retrieve the single-shot derringer nested in a holster about his fleshy calf above his sock and shoe. It would be easier to whistle for his two mastiff men, but he wasn't sure he could even conjure up enough spit. While all that went through his mind, the two burly men appeared to either side of him.
Oh, good. Control that beast.
Pullcross nodded toward the glaring woman, who was in the midst of smiling and sneering and feinting a lunge at the tuxedoed gawkers. The two big men bookended her, gripped her thin arms, and held her rigid. She whipped her head side to side, trying in vain to bite them. She kicked them each in the shins. Neither man moved. With a growl of surrender, she once more stood still, breathing hard and glaring at everyone. Meanwhile, Denton I. Pullcross had bent to the rocking, shrieking man.
Ellis, you damned fool, look what you've done. Get the hell out of here, he growled through gritted teeth.
Trying to shield the spectacle of the blood-faced idiot from the crowd had little effect.
Me? Whined Ellis. She bit my nose off.
If you don't get away from me, I'll bite your fool head off.
Pullcross shoved the blubbering man through the panel door, then slammed it shut. He turned and had to work to pull his gaze away from the bloody mess the fool had made of his carpet. Emboldened by the presence of his burly men restraining the woman, he moved close to her right side.
Turn your face so they can't see that scar.
She acted as if she hadn't heard him. He growled and once again walked to the center of the room, half occupied with thoughts of how to have Ellis killed, Looking over the crowd, Pullcross laughed. Ah ha ha, what a show, eh? Imagine how fun she'd be. Silence filled the room, save for the low growl from the woman's throat. All right now, who'll start things off? Who'll give me $1,000 for this dusky beauty? The group's taste for this particular dish had been lost in the frenzy. She smiled and stood tall, no longer looking any of them in the eye. 500? A mere $500 would buy you more satisfaction than... And a case of hydrophobia, I dare say, shouted someone from the far side of the room. It might have been the visiting Duke of Orrington, thought Pullcross. Or perhaps Chester Rockwood, the railroad tycoon. He couldn't be sure which. Didn't matter. The chance was lost, and his investment in the creature, too. Denton pasted on an even wider smile. For that money, I'm tempted to keep her for myself. You'll need more chains, what? Definitely that annoying Duke. Trust a royal to be that insufferable. Denton Pullcross stepped closer to the tall, beautiful woman in their midst and spoke loud enough for her alone to hear. I'll have you chopped and ground up. Then I'll feed you to my pigs. Then I'll feed you to this lot. That's what I'll do, you exotic thing, you. He sneered as he turned away, but not before catching sight of the slightest tremor on the girl's lip. Was that fear? Good. I'll pay you 500 for her. Denton turned to see a trim man, not overly tall, with black hair and a sculpted black waxed mustache, standing beside the woman. Who is he? Oh, yes, I've seen him before. Previous infrequent visits, in town on business, he'd said. Denton recalled the man was one of those who'd made their fortune out west, in the heathen lands. Some idiot who'd lucked into a gold mine and could likely buy and sell the lot of them. Bet he doesn't know quality from quantity, Denton told himself. Nonetheless, treat this one well. One never knows what the future might bring. He turned with a smile, hoping the man had not seen the scar running from her right eye and curving down her cheek to her chin. 600, sir. Heck, maybe it didn't matter to him. Some men like that sort of thing. And the fact that she was bloodthirsty hadn't deterred the man from stepping forth. When the man nodded his agreement, Denton said over his shoulder, Come to my office for a drink and a bill of sale for the 600. He led the way. The trim man followed with one backward glance at the woman. He winked at her. Now that the fun was over, most of the other men had filed back toward the main room and other distractions. Pullcross and the buyer vacated the room as well, leaving the two burly brutes who held the arms of the tall woman in the pretty red dress with dark bloodstains smearing the front. They didn't move. She did move, or at least tried to. Once more, she kicked at them, tried to surprise them with a lunge, twisting out of their grasp. Nothing changed, save for their tightening grips on her arms. Once more, she gave up. What next? She thought. Less than an hour later, she found herself seated in a sumptuous hansom cab, rolling through the rain-wet streets of St. Paul. She was still chained, although bound with her hands in her lap, and manacles of a thicker steel than the gold chain had been. Couldn't break that one, she reasoned. I'm not about to break this one. The man who had paid $600 for her had draped his wool cloak over her shoulders. She'd given thought to shaking it off, but it was warm. The last thing she wanted was to come down with a creeping, coughing sickness that would drain her strength. She'd need it, always had, always would. She sat rigid at the far end of the seat and did not look at him. She figured she'd become his love slave or some such. It had happened before, 3 times, in fact, always to wealthy white men. They'd treat her okay, buy her things, expect a whole lot in return. One man's wife got wind of her and had tried to kill her with a knife. The old man had her sent away, sold her, she later found out, to one of his card-playing pals. He'd not been nice at all, that card player. For a fellow who spent a whole lot of time gambling, he wasn't very good at it. He'd bet her one night and lost her. She wasn't sad to go, as he could be nasty when he was in his cups. The night of the card game, she'd ended up dragged to the home of the winning player. He'd been the worst of all so far. He was a man who liked to scuff his knuckles across a woman's body. He'd only hit her in the face once, though. Guess he didn't like seeing her once pretty face, sporting buttoned-up eyes and a split lip. Instead, he took to punching and kicking at her body. She'd be stiff and sore, but she could still manage to do what she was supposed to do. Eventually, he'd told her he'd grown tired of her. She'd overheard he was to be married. God help that woman, she'd thought. But to choose such as him? Maybe the fool didn't want God's help. She'd beg for it before long. His impending marriage had led him to take her north to St. Paul, and so she'd found herself at Pullcross's Gentleman's Club, not without first being handled by the master of the place. She'd tried to get the attention of the other women in the place, see if she could get help somehow. Not a one of them would even look at her. That had been 2 weeks ago. Then she learned she was being saved for a special event, that's what Pullcross had called it. She got pushed once too often by that weasel-faced Ellis, always squeezing her and making nasty sounds behind her, before jumping out of her way with a laugh. She got him, though, in that damn homely nose of his. She hoped he didn't have some sort of nose disease, but it had been worth it. Just to hear him scream had been lovely. And there she was, bought and paid for once again. The man spoke. "Aren't you going to ask me who I am, or how I came to be there?" She said nothing, did not even look at him. "Do you trust me?" She shook her head. "You're right not to, of course. You don't know me from Adam." They rode in silence a moment more. Then he said, "I trust you." She looked at him with raised eyebrows. He smiled and nodded. "Now, how about if I unlock those awful chains?" She stared at him. "It's true. Here." He reached into a vest pocket, tweezered out a skeleton key, and handed it to her. Her sharp eyes regarded him with a somewhat softening look. From her end of the seat, she regarded him with narrowed eyes. "Fine. How did you happen to be there?" "Oh," he glanced at her, and his eyes widened. "Oh, good heavens, no, I am not the sort to frequent such places. Rather, I was in town on other business, and got wind of the frankly repugnant dealings taking place at that den of iniquity." The man's face reddened and shook, and he spat the words as if they were hot coals in his mouth. He glanced at her and saw that her brow had risen. "My apologies, ma'am. That such things occur in this enlightened age is too much, really." The young woman remained wary. And yet something about him was different. She didn't quite know what made him so, but it was there. Whatever he might turn out to be, he was different. And he had presented her with the opportunity to leave. It's not like she had anywhere else to go. No money, nearly no clothes, no friends, no kin, no nothing. Just like always. And so Zadie decided not to jump out of the carriage just yet. She'd stick with him at least for a little while. At least until the train depot. And then she'd decide. When they arrived at the depot, he made her button up the cloak. "So as not to catch a chill," he said. Then he held the door for her and bought tickets while she waited. She hoped there would be food. It had been nearly 2 days since she'd eaten, and then it had been cold boiled potatoes and the heel of a gone-by loaf of bread. He bought 2 steaming cups of coffee from inside while she waited for him outside. "For obvious but unfortunate reasons," he said, then brought out the cups of coffee for them to sip. "While they ready my car." And though she hated to admit it, that impressed her. He handed her 1 cup. "I hope you don't mind, but I took the liberty of ordering yours with cream and a little sugar added. I guessed." He shrugged. She decided that was a kindly gesture. They did not talk while they sipped their coffee. It was good, but too sweet. She would not say so, though. He began to speak, looked down, said, "No, no." "What is it?" she said, maybe too quickly. He touched the right side of his face with a fingertip and shrugged. She knew right away it was the scar, always the scar they wanted to know about. Couldn't blame them, really. It was not something everybody wore. She sighed. "I'm sorry," he said. "It's not any of my business. I shouldn't have asked."
"No, it's all right. It happened when I was a child."
But she did not want to say any more, could not bring herself to. She didn't know this man at all, and the night was wearing on her. All she wanted to do was stretch out and sleep for a week. Before he could say something else, a lean fellow in grubby work clothes came along and nodded to the man. She guessed his rail car was ready, whatever that might mean. They followed the fellow, who didn't much look like a porter. He led them along a long line of cars down the tracks to where the darkness threw deep shadows. She slowed her pace and looked at the man. He smiled and nodded. "Here we are." Round about then, she began to feel ill, and not a jittery, jumpy sort of ill, but a bad, down-in-the-gut ill. Before she knew it, whoop, up came whatever little she'd had in her gullet. She felt embarrassed and began to apologize, but the man laughed. "That sometimes happens." She fell right over onto her backside, and he laughed some more. Before she knew it, the lanky fella who'd been leading them down along the train cars lifted her up and draped her over his shoulder like she was a sack of meal. The worst of it was she knew it all was happening, could see it, smell it, hear it, feel it. But her sight blurred and buzzed like when you run too fast on a hot, sticky day. She tried to speak, but the words came out sounding like mud looked, all thick and wet. The kind man laughed some more, and the lanky man walked up what felt like a ramp. It was dark until somebody lit a lamp, and the man carrying her lay her down. "Oh, good," she thought. "At least I'll be in this train car and I can get some rest. It's been a long day, a long week, month. Heck, it's been a long old life." The lamplight came closer, making her sight all buzzy and blurry. Sound came and went like it was being pushed and pulled somehow to each side of her head. The light showed her the divan she was on was all raw wood and tall up the sides like a box. Like she was inside a wooden box. She noticed she was laying on shredded straw or some such. "What's this?" Voices. She heard voices. The 2 men were talking. The man who'd brought her leaned down and looked at her. "You're feeling under the weather, eh? Well, you get yourself some sleep." He smiled, and it was different from the way he'd smiled at her earlier. Yes, sir, something was definitely different about this man. Zadie tried to push herself up out of the mess of straw, but her arms just would not do her bidding. Same with her legs. A scraping sound stopped her feeble efforts. Like a door being closed above her, the light from the lamp in the man's hand began to narrow. Suddenly she knew what it was. Someone was sliding a lid on the box. The box she was in was going to be closed up, like a coffin. No, no. She thrashed her head side to side. No, this can't be right.
can't be.
In a dusty corner somewhere inside her, Zadie found where her voice had been hiding. She grabbed it and used it, making it work once more. It wasn't a pretty sound, more like a squawk, but it worked. Then she kept on with it, until she was shouting pretty well. Not words, really, but sounds. Animal sounds, sure, but sounds. It didn't seem to matter. That lid kept sliding, tightening the light, pinching it out. Just before it slid into place, the man leaned close and looked through the gap, smiling. "See you in Deadwood, my dear." The lid slid into place, and the sound of a hammer nailing it down drowned out the young woman's muffled shouts from within. Chapter 2. "Rise and shine, you dusky delight." Zadie had been awake for some time, perhaps hours. It was tricky to know. They hadn't been pleasant hours. Her head thud, thud, thudded like a cannonade. Nor were they even comfortable hours, but at least they were enough to convince her she hadn't been buried alive in that crate. Her last memories had been seeing that wooden cover slide over her, then the nailing, and screaming, screaming, screaming until she could no longer scream. And then nothing until this morning. She knew it was morning because it was cold, and the light had barely begun to show itself when she first woke. "I trust you've had a pleasant sleep. I rarely touch the stuff myself. Sleep, I mean. It has a nasty way of ruining a perfectly good late-night card game or drinking session or, well, anything at all." As the man spoke, he slowly walked in a crescent some feet before her hunched form. For the first time, Zadie saw she wore not the tiny red dress that barely covered her, but some sort of sacking like burlap. It itched when she'd shifted onto her backside. Bound with thick manacles about her wrists and ankles, she was chained once more. The chains might be attached to a ring in the wall. She leaned back from her hunched sitting position once and felt something cold, perhaps steel, touch her back. The room had a plank floor, plank walls, and a window to her left, too far to reach, even if she could stand. She'd never felt so sore, so weak, so dried out, so confused. Since waking and coming into her mind once more, however raw and fuzzy it was, she had but one question. What did the man want with her? And there he was, the same man who'd seemed so kind, who'd seemed, for a time anyway, there might be one good person in the world, one person who didn't want her dead or hated her because of her looks. Others had only wanted one thing, also because of her looks. All that thinking made her headache and pound like a war drum right behind her eyeballs. "Tipsy here will tend to you." Zadie heard dragging footsteps draw closer. From beneath her hair, Zadie saw 2 feet, one in a shoe, the other oddly shaped, wrapped in rags. Whoever it was set down a tin pail beside the feet. Water slopped out the side, slight steam rose from it in the cold morning air of the room. A work-reddened hand, a woman's hand, draped a grimy rag over the edge of the bucket, and another hand set a hunk of lye soap onto the wooden floor beside the pail. He walked forward, hunkered low before her, and spoke, his voice low and uncurling like steel smoke, rust flaking from it. "A handy hint, my dear, before you get it in your pretty head to turn rogue once more and somehow fight your way out of this situation in which you find yourself." He waited. Long enough, she guessed, for her to look up at him. She did not. He sighed and continued. "You will not, in fact, win, ever. You will not escape. You will not do anything in your life from here on out but what I tell you to do. To illustrate what I mean, I'll tell you a little story. Let's see. Once and only once, a long time ago now, a woman, let's call her Tipsy, tried to run away. Actually, she succeeded, at least for a mile or so. But men, my men, in fact, yes, I have several men who specialize in such situations, tracked her. I'll wager you've come across them, or at least their kind, sometime in your dark past. He chuckled at his petty joke. They used to be slave chasers. Tracked them down and hauled them back for their bounty. Sometimes, though, depending on the circumstance, they could only bring back a head in a sack. I forbid such behavior, though. Ruins a perfectly good investment. He sighed. At any rate, they tracked her and found her and brought her back here. By that time, I had figured out two things. One, I needed a maid. And two, a maid really only needs 1.5 feet. Zadie heard a stifled gasp and sob. The man chuckled, a low grating sound like sand grinding between steel. More or less. My aim may have been off that day. In my defense, axes aren't the most precise of instruments. But it got me my maid, didn't it, Tipsy?
Yes, Al.
The voice was a whisper. It also stopped all that silly running away nonsense, didn't it, Tipsy?
Yes, Al.
Al, thought Zadie. The man's name is Al. Somehow in her fuzzy mind, she was desperate to make clear again. Knowing his name seemed important. He stood. As I say, very simple rules, really. Half turning, he said, the sooner you understand them, the sooner you will begin to understand we are all one big family here. Maybe not the happiest you'll find, he shrugged. But then again, who really is happy anyway? Maybe you'll be able to tell me one day. Zadie? That got her. Zadie looked up for the first time, wondering how he'd found out her name. She didn't recall telling anyone her real name, ever. Then again, nobody had ever drugged her before. What else had she said? What else had she done? He laughed, a sound as low and menacing as his speaking voice, but without words. It reminded Zadie once again of the sound she'd heard as the lid on the crate slid over her. Oh, Tipsy.
Yes, Al.
The voice was scratchy, as if the woman had spent too much time shouting or screaming. Be careful of this one. He opened the door. She bites. Chapter 3. 1 month later.
And furthermore,
said the chunky, red-faced mayor of the little mountain mining town of Boar Gulch, Chauncey Wheeler.
Most especially on the Sabbath. There is no call for showing such.
The little fat man scratched at his short black and gray flecked beard and squinted up at the timbers of the ceiling in the Last Drop saloon, as if the words he was searching for might have been carved there by some guiding hand. Blatant disregard? Heathenistic attitudes? Immoral behavior? Offered Nosy Parker. The slender scribe in a bowler hat, sporting one bullet hole through the crown, rocked back on his heels, pleased with his word choices.
Yes, Chauncey's pink, pudgy hands smacked together. All of those, and more, no doubt.
The stout fellow stood facing the four men he'd been excoriating, his eyes wide, his chest heaving, and his pink fists balled at his sides. His silver watch chain swung slightly with the effort he'd just expended. The men stared back, their eyes too slightly wide. The man standing behind the bar was one Rollie Stoneface Finnegan, former Pinkerton operative and current co-owner of the Last Drop Saloon. His business partner, Jubal Pops Tennyson, a robust man, all bone and muscle, stood nearby with his corncob pipe clamped in his teeth, his thumbs hooked on the straps of his denim coveralls. His eyes glinted, and he was the likeliest among them to cut loose with a chuckle. To his left stood the aforementioned Nosy Parker, and seated at the bar was Wolfbait, a wizened old fellow with long gray beard and mustache, a hawk nose, and a piercing look in his eyes. All held cups of fresh hot coffee. Rollie broke the silence. Chauncey, the mayor regarded him with a cold, imperious look. What? Would you like a cup of coffee? As if he'd been asked to throw a kitten off a clifftop, the mayor ground his teeth together tighter and sputtered a growl as he stalked out the door he'd stormed through not 2 minutes before. He'd barely gotten down the half dozen steps outside, back to the gulch's dusty main street, when Pops let loose with a low whistle and a chuckle. Rollie ran a calloused hand through his peppered hair and smoothed his trim beard. What brought all that on? The men once more exchanged wide-eyed looks of disbelief, all except Wolfbait, who sat wheezing out a silent laugh on his stool. Rollie leaned on the bar with both hands. Out with it.
Oh, I would.
The old rascal offered up a couple of dainty coughs.
But I'm dry, son. Dry as a puckered plank in the middle of a droughty summer.
He glanced up from beneath his furry brows, a look of hope in his roomy old eyes. Rollie sighed and poured the old-timer a beer. Wolfbait sipped, smacked his lips, and said nothing. The rest of the men closed in, verbally assaulting him.
All right, said Wolfbait, sipping once again.
He dragged his cuff across his frothy mustache.
The reason Chauncey's got a knot in his knickers is on account of the fact before too long a new arrival is expected in Boar Gulch.
Why's that got him all worked up? Said Pops, sipping his coffee. We get new folks drifting through all the time.
Not like this. It's a fellow wearing a collar and a black suit and toting a Bible.
Since when did Chauncey Wheeler go in for religion? Asked Rollie.
Doesn't, said Wolfbait, sipping his beer. But he does give two figs for the ladies.
Ladies? I don't follow your thinking, said Nosy.
Who can? Pops winked.
If I wasn't so tough, I'd likely resent that remark, Pops.
Good thing you're made of old boot leather, Wolfbait. I have a few such comments of my own if you don't get on with your story. I haven't gotten a beer's worth of satisfaction from you yet.
Okay, okay. Boy, you three are about as impatient as a
Wolfbait.
Rollie smacked his hands on the bar top.
Yeah, well, seems that new sky pilot's got himself a certain widowed sister.
That elicited a few raised eyebrows. Nosy said, what's that got to do with Chauncey? Most people in the world have close relatives, many of whom have lost loved ones in a tragic way. I imagine the poor woman's husband was taken from this earth in a most cruel fashion, perhaps a knifing or a skirmish in some brutal battle somewhere.
Pops shook his head, smiling. You best scratch that down in your journal, Mr. Writer Man.
Ain't the woman's dead husband Chauncey is interested in, you ninny, said Wolfbait. It's the woman herself.
Wheeler knew the preacher a long time ago as school chums, recalled his sister, too.
That sly fox, said Pops.
Nosy's furrowed brow relaxed.
Ah, now I see.
Rollie knocked on the bar.
I wish the mayor luck.
Why?
He's gonna need it.
Oh, I don't know about that, said Nosy. He is the mayor, after all. A landowner and founder of the town.
Yeah, but look around, said Rollie. It's a hard sell for most women.
There aren't that many about. Sure, there's Mrs. Pulaski at the Lucky Strike. And there's Sal. She and Peter seem happy up there on the hill at the blacksmith shop.
And the women under Miss Madge Gladwell's care, said Wolfbait with a wink.
Sure, agreed Rollie. But how many genuinely enjoy living here? They all commiserated by nodding and saying,
That's true.
A commotion outside interrupted their brooding. Voices drew nearer. Then they heard steps on the stairs leading up to the porch.
Chauncey back to give us heathens a second dose, said Pops.
All four men turned to face the open door, and in silhouette appeared a woman. She stood still, tugging off her gloves, then stepped inside slowly. Despite the always dusty ride into the gulch, her dark blue traveling coat and skirts, rimmed with black piping, looked remarkably clean, free of dust, and fresh somehow. She even wore one of those fancy hats pinned atop a pile of shiny auburn hair. With no use other than as a decoration, the hat appeared to have a spray of tiny white flowers pinned with a lavender ribbon. On her, such a frivolity worked like a charm. Her figure was trim where it ought to be, fulsome in all the other right places, and her half-grin, half-smirk seemed to indicate she knew what men thought when they looked at her. All four men stared at her a few moments too long. She eyed them each, one at a time, her eyes landing on Rollie last, and they stayed there. Finally, he regained his sense and in a husky voice said,
Ma'am?
She smiled, strode the last few paces to the bar, and squeezed in between Wolfbait and Nosey. Wolfbait slid off his customary stool.
Won't you have a seat, ma'am?
She smiled at him as if he were a cute dog. She still didn't speak, but remained standing.
You smell lovely, said Nosey.
Rollie rolled his eyes. Pops chuckled and drew on his pipe. Finally, looking at Rollie, she said,
I assume you are Rollie Finnegan?
Uh-huh.
He nodded, then seemed to come to himself.
Yes, I mean, why?
He was torn between gazing at this fetching young beauty and being wary of her. She would not be the first pretty young woman to saunter on in there. He remembered just such a scene, not too many months before, with Miss Delia Holsapple, daughter of one of his former arrestees, an embezzler who'd hanged himself in jail. The young woman had, since her father's suicide, dedicated her life to vengeance, blaming Rollie for everything bad that had since happened to her and her family. She'd come to a sad and still somewhat mysterious end herself in the gulch, found dead by Chauncey in a cabin he'd rented to her in exchange for services everyone knew about, but no one wanted to talk about. The import of her presence in the gulch had been her prepaid newspaper ads, which she'd taken out all over the country, telling every criminal everywhere just where to find Rollie. He and Pops were still fighting them off. Still, this young woman was something else. Pops stepped forward.
What my fumble-tongued business partner here is trying to say is yes, that's Rollie. I'm Pops Tennyson.
He doffed his bowler.
And this here's Nosey Parker, speaker of awkward statements. And that old knot on bone is Wolfbait.
Are you a widow? Said Nosey.
She gave him a narrow-eyed stare. What a silly question. Do I look like a widow?
You don't look like no widow I ever seen, said Wolfbait, smiling up at her.
She nodded and smiled at them all again. Then she unpinned her hat and set it on the bar top. I am pleased to make all of your acquaintances, I'm sure. As for me, I am Tish Gray, and I am here at the behest of my employer. She returned her gaze to Rollie. You know him well, I am quite certain, Mr. Finnegan.
I know lots of folks, ma'am.
This one is your former employer, Mr. Alan Pinkerton. Rollie's eyes narrowed, and his slight polite smile disappeared as his face hardened before them. I can see it's true, she said, watching him.
What's that?
You really did earn your nickname of Stoneface.
Never liked that name.
I don't blame you, she said. It does a disservice to stone everywhere.
Pops let out a full-throated laugh. She's got you there, Rollie. Oh, I like this young lady.
Everyone expected Rollie to ask her what it was the infamous Pinkerton wished of him, but he asked a different question.
Would you like a cup of coffee, Miss Gray?
Those words weakened her cool, amused demeanor. She recovered quickly. That would be most kind of you, Mr. Finnegan.
Call me Rollie, he said, pouring a cupful.
Rollie, then. As she sipped, Pops went on about sliding chairs off the tables and righting them, busying for the day. Nosy and Wolfbait lingered, unabashed. Rollie knew the old man no longer cared what people thought of him. Hell, he wasn't certain Wolfbait had ever cared about such things. He was a crusty old rockhound with an interesting past. The same with most folks squirreled away in the mountains, rummaging for color, the one nugget or pure seam that would change their fortunes forever. Wolfbait had led himself one heck of a life so far, from a youth as a schoolteacher back east to a series of boom and bust strikes in the mountains of the west. His latter years had been filled with more bust, likely owing to the old man's penchant for beer and palaver. But he was a foxy old gent, handy with a gun, and fearless as a cornered badger when pushed. As for Nosy, well, he was just plain peculiar. Odd behavior was not unexpected, nor uncommon, where he was concerned. He wasn't even due for work until the late afternoon, which didn't deter him from lurking about in the mornings. Rollie didn't much mind, as the man was astute and helpful, if odd. When he got up to his life's work, the writing of dime novels, Rollie wasn't certain, but considering that most mornings Nosy looked as though he'd been dragged backward through a knothole, Rollie surmised the young scribe spent his overnight hours writing. Well, said Nosy, looking at Rollie.
Well, what?
Nosy sighed. Aren't you going to ask the lovely Miss Gray what it is that Mr. Pinkerton might want from you? He turned a smarmy smile on the young lady. Not that any of us mind the company of such a fetching emissary. You are a smooth one, Mr. Parker, she said, sipping her coffee. He smiled until she continued. But then again, so are river rocks.
And baby's bottoms, said Pops from across the room.
He followed it with a low chuckle and relit his pipe, then shook the match once and stuffed it down the off-scorched front pocket of his bib-front trousers. Tish Gray smiled at him, then nodded. Mr. Tennyson, you appear to be on fire.
Huh?
He looked down and saw that once again his overalls were smoking. He patted himself vigorously.
Thank you, ma'am. Don't worry, said Rollie. He's too full of bull to burn. And you're too ornery not to, said Pops.
Uh-oh, she said. I appear to have touched off a fuse.
No, they're forever going on in such ways. Like an old married couple they are.
Wolfbait shook his head and downed the last of his beer, then wrapped his hands on the bar top and stood.
Well, I have to get going. He touched his hat brim. Nice to meet you, ma'am. Got me a long day of sitting in the sun to get started on.
On his way out, he said to Nosy,
Tell me how all this works out, boy. I can't stand the suspense.
Waving over his shoulder, he left. Miss Gray turned her attention to Rollie. Well, Mr. Finnegan, how about it?
It?
Aren't you the least bit curious as to why Mr. Pinkerton sent a messenger out here to track down the infamous Stoneface Finnegan?
I have a pretty good idea of what he wants.
And that is?
Rollie sighed and paused in wiping down the already gleaming bar top. He wants me to work for him again.
She smiled and nodded. Yes, that's it in a nutshell, though he explained it in more detail.
He would. Alan J. Pinkerton was always windy. Why say it in two words when he could pollute the air with 50?
She looked disappointed. He said he had been wrong to let you go, regrets it, and hopes you will reconsider. I brought you a letter from him.
Rollie emerged from behind the bar and made for the back room where crates of liquor were kept. Keep it. I'm not interested.
Not at all.
Not in the least.
Rollie left the bar room, and once he'd closed the storeroom door behind them, he smiled a little. It was a flattering thought, and something he'd long considered. He'd loved his work, and he was very good at it.
His thoughts flicked back to that early spring day a couple of years before, when he'd been bushwhacked in Denver City, after testifying in court against old Chance Filbert, yet another arrestee. On his way to Hazel's Hash House to enjoy a celebratory slice of pie and a cup of bold hot coffee, he'd been knifed from behind several times and left for dead. But he hadn't died. He had, however, been forced to retire from the agency, retire from the one and only thing in his life that pulled him from bed each morning. He didn't blame Pinkerton for his injuries, but he did blame him for not sticking by him. All Rollie had gotten from the man for too many years of unrivaled success as a manhunter was a pocket watch. Until now, that is.
He let you come out here on your own, said Rollie, emerging from the back room.
He's even more callous than I remember.
She narrowed her eyes. Nobody lets me do anything in life, Mr. Finnegan, thank you very much.
Then what is it you want?
Rollie smacked his rag to the bar and stared at her, hands on his hips. For the first time, she looked flummoxed.
What's the matter? I call your bluff, did I?
She nodded. Yes. But since you asked, I want to learn from your experience.
You hear that, Rollie? Said Pops. That's what young folks say when they talk about old people.
No, not like that. She rolled her eyes. You see, Mr. Finnegan, for me and for a whole lot of others in the biz, Stoneface Finnegan defines the meaning of a true, no-nonsense operative. I want to be your apprentice. I want to learn every trick in your book, Mr. Finnegan. I want to learn everything about the manhunting trade.
Rollie groaned. Once again, he ran for the back door, knowing he had to get out of there before he said something in a woman's presence he'd regret. Apprentice, foolishness, Rollie sputtered, moving a shovel and an axe from one spot in their old shed to another, then moved them back.
Nosey poked his head into the doorway.
You know, now that she's found you, her sage, her oracle, she strikes me as the sort of person who will not be denied. She will not give up until you teach her.
Rollie said nothing, but sunk the axe deep into the chopping block.
If you ask me, that tenacity is perhaps the most important trait a person engaged in detective work could have. Nobody asked you, Nosey.
With a smile on his face, the writer had already turned toward the bar. Later, in that quiet hour before the afternoon regulars began wandering in, Nosey was out back, burning their trash pile, and Rollie and Pops found themselves alone in the bar.
What do you think of our new visitor? Said Pops. I'm not convinced she came out here because Pinkerton asked her to. He's capable of a whole lot of weaselly behavior, but even he wouldn't send a young, inexperienced woman out here on her own, and on a fool's errand to boot. She's out here on her own?
Rollie shrugged.
And what'd she really want?
Again, Rollie shrugged.
That's what I'm not certain of. Maybe it's as simple as wanting to learn how to be a detective. Hell, I don't know. I do know she bears watching. Or have you forgotten all those people who come here to hunt me down? I haven't forgotten a thing. Still carry the scars from tangling with a few. I will say she certainly seems keen about learning your former trade. Yeah, well, she can go back where she came from and play with dolls or needlework. Oh, I think you're selling her short, Rollie. I know. Look, it's not you she came out here for. Nor you, come down to it. She came out here to get information, to learn. What's the harm in that?
Rollie grumbled something, but Pops just chuckled. The seed was planted in Raleigh's mind, he could tell. The irascible sleuth was thinking about something, and that was never a bad thing. It would come out eventually. And it did, sooner than Pops expected. Nursing a cup of tepid coffee, Rollie said,
You know, she sort of reminds me of myself at her age.
Ha, said Pops.
I can't believe you were as pretty as all that.
Rollie frowned at him.
Don't be foolish. I mean, she's fiery and reckless and hungry. I don't mind that in a young person.
This mean you're going to let her hang around, old-timer?
Who are you calling old? Rollie growled. But yeah, maybe. We should at least talk.
Good, said a voice from the doorway. The two men turned to see Miss Gray once more.
Don't get any ideas, said Rollie. I meant me talking you out of being foolish. Nothing good can come of you pursuing this line of work, young lady.
Oh, how sweet, she said. You're already teaching me.
Teaching you?
Yes, how to say one thing when you really mean another.
She winked at Pops as she walked by him. He smiled and shook his head as he chucked a few more sticks into the stove.
I'm already regretting this, mumbled Rollie to Pops. I'll blame you when it all blows up in our faces.
Me? Said Pops, holding up his hands.
I'm just an innocent bystander here. Bystander, yep, but innocent, huh.
Rollie looked at the young woman.
I can tell you one thing right now.
Anything, she said, pulling out a small notebook and a pencil.
Nosey walked back in and clutched his chest.
Ah, a woman who writes. You are a seductress, madam.
And you are a cad, she said, but smiled before turning back to Rollie. Now, you were about to tell me something about the sleuthing game?
Yep, and it's this.
He leaned forward. So did she.
I will never, ever, ever work for Alan Pinkerton again. Not even in death. Is that clear?
That's not a lesson, Rollie. And I'm not surprised, given the way he treated you.
You're not?
No. And neither are any of the other detectives, particularly we of the young breed of investigators.
Why is that? Said Pops.
Because among those who know about such things, Rollie Stoneface Finnegan is a veritable legend. You, sir, are an idol, and plenty among us fairly worship you.
That's foolish, he said. You don't even know me. If you did, said Pops, you'd run from here as fast as your pretty legs could carry you.
That set him off on a chuckle lasting the length of the bar and farther. He swung the front door wide, and in wandered a couple of early regulars, Bone and his son, Bone Jr. Barely scratching by, and they were always about, eager to tackle the grimiest of chores for a dollar and a beer. Sometimes just a beer.
Be that as it may, said Tish Gray. I have my boot wedged firmly in the door, and I'm not leaving until I learn everything I can from you, Mr. Finnegan, about the trade of manhunting.
Rollie faced the back wall and rubbed his temples hard. Chapter 4. On their advice, Miss Gray rented a tiny cabin from Peter and Sal, not far from the newer, larger cabin he'd built closer to his smithy. They'd mentioned to Rollie just the week before their intention to rent it out on a short-term basis to newcomers. It had been Peter's first abode when he'd come to town. Then he'd met Sal, the woman who'd tended his wounds after the grievous, vicious battle Cleve Danziger and his band of men, one of the many headhunting hordes seeking the bounty on Raleigh's pate, had brought to the town. She'd tended Peter's wounds, they'd hit it off, and her days of drifting from one man's camp to another had ended. What she'd sought and not found with any of them, she finally found with Peter, and he with her. Though he never mentioned it to anyone, in an odd way, Rollie felt responsible for them having found each other in such a manner. Their happiness brought him happiness. He'd not found it himself thus far with any woman. But then again, he'd never sought it for longer than a quiet, humbling experience with a prostitute could bring. Of late, he'd been keeping a regular weekly appointment with Madge Gladwell, the madam of the women who'd moved in and taken over Chauncey's aborted town hall. Madge had quietly paid off Chauncey's substantial outstanding debt on the unfinished structure. She had also since come to terms with Chauncey, who knew what that might mean, and purchased the land on which the building sat, ending his dreams of owning and operating a grand hotel or town meeting hall. No one quite knew what Chauncey's dream for the property had been.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.